It's like a storm that cuts a path. It breaks your will. It feels like that. You think you're lost, but you're not lost on your own. You're not alone.
It was the spring that followed a brutal winter in 1950 where the temperature reached record lows of 22 degrees below zero when the Whitehead family experienced one of their deepest tragedies. Six-month-old Glenda Rose, the third-born child of Jimmie and Katherine, succumbed to pneumonia. With no access to emergency medical help, the family faced a grim reality. The nearest hospital was 44 miles away in Vicksburg. With no transportation, this was not an option. Calling for help was not an option as there was no phone service. 19-year-old Katherine cradled Glenda in her arms, nervously pacing back and forth, causing the wooden floorboards to squeak. Despite this, little Glenda continued to struggle to breathe, her cries barely audible. Holding on to hope, Katherine's emotions dissipated into grief, despair, and anger. Did she dare ask, "Why hast thou forsaken me in my hour of greatest need?" She had done everything she could to keep her baby warm and well-nourished, but the brutal winter cold crept through the wooden walls, creating a harsh environment for a fragile infant. When Glenda's breathing grew shallower and more labored, accompanied by a dangerously high fever, 16-year-old Irene, Katherine's younger sister, who also lived on the CM plantation a walking distance away, desperately tried to help. She placed a warm, wet towel over the baby's nose not only to break up the nasal congestion, but also to serve as a barrier to suck it out by mouth, hoping against all odds to restore the baby's breath. But it was too late. Glenda's small body grew limp, and the rattling sounds from her lungs were no more. Her soul was released to the dead of night as the faint warmth of life slipped away. The midwife, summoned from the nearby community, in a hushed voice of surrender, pronounced her dead. The pronouncement shattered Katherine and Jimmie. There were no cries, no calls for help left to be made. The helplessness in that moment was overwhelming. Jimmie, a man of few words, never left Katherine's side. How could a life so innocent and small be taken soon? A question he dared not to ask of a higher power. Glenda's lifeless body was neatly bundled up and placed on the ironing board. Here she would remain until arrangements could be made for transport to the hospital at the break of day. Katherine, still filled with the nurturing instinct to hold and protect, stayed close to her baby, unwilling to let go. The ironing board. In the dim glow of kerosene lanterns, the small wooden house on the C.M. Davis plantation silently stands, a grief-stricken family totally surrendered to the tragedy that has just unfolded within its walls. The air is still, except for the occasional creaking of the floorboards. The temperature has only recently lifted from the brutal winter that witnessed new record low temperatures, yet the chill of that season lingers, cutting through the thin wooden planks of the home. In the faint light, six-month-old Glenda Rose's lifeless form lies bundled neatly on an old ironing board in the center of the room. There is no crib or bassinet, only the makeshift resting place of iron and wood, a stark symbol of the family's poverty and helplessness. Her small body is wrapped tightly in a thin blanket, her stillness a jarring contrast to the faint flicker of the lantern's flame. Katherine, just 19 years old, stands beside the ironing board, her shoulders slumped with the weight of grief. Her face is pale and streaked with tears, eyes red and swollen from hours of crying and praying. Her hands tremble slightly, still aching to cradle her baby. Yet, she dares not reach out, as if doing so would confirm the permanence of Glenda's absence. Every breath she takes is heavy with despair, a silent cry to the heavens, "Why hast thou forsaken me in my hour of greatest need?" Beside her, Jimmie is equally devastated. He stands motionless, one hand resting gently on Katherine's shoulder, the other clenching a tattered handkerchief. A man of few words, his eyes remain fixed on the small, still form of his daughter. There are no tears left to shed, only a deep, hollow ache that seems to permeate the room. He struggles silently with the unanswered question, how a life so innocent and small could be taken so soon. In the background, Irene stands with tears streaming down her face. Her earlier attempts to save Glenda seem futile now, and her shoulders shake with silent sobs. She covers her mouth to stifle the sound, as if even grief must be muted in the presence of death. The dim lantern light casts long shadows across her face, deepening the lines of sorrow etched into her young features. Near the corner of the room, 3-year-old Mathis and nearly 2-year-old Bertha stand barefoot on the splintered wooden floor. They are dressed in thin, worn nightshirts, instinctively drawn to the unfolding scene, yet somehow aware of its solemnity. Mathis clutches his sister's hand, his small eyes wide with the confusion that only children can know. Too young to grasp the finality of death, but old enough to feel the heaviness that fills the room. Bertha, in her oversized diaper, sucks her thumb and leans against her brother, as if seeking comfort in his familiar presence. Their silent cries merge with the overall sense of mourning. The room, lit only by the flickering yellow glow of the kerosene lanterns, is cold and sparse. The walls are rough planks, offering little insulation against the remnants of winter's chill. The floor, splintered and uneven, is covered only by a thin layer of dust, an unwanted reminder of the family's poverty. There is a palpable sense of isolation, magnified by the midnight hour, as the family is utterly alone in their grief. Outside, the stillness of the plantation night presses heavily on the house. The absence of sound, no rustling leaves, no distant calls from farm animals, only adds to the profound silence within. It is a silence that is both oppressive and sacred, marking not only the passing of a child, but also the fragile nature of hope in the face of overwhelming circumstances.